1947, when the two nations became independent, Kashmir's Maharaja and Kashmir's popular leader, Sheikh Saab, both chose to join India. That was a very odd situation for a country, for leaders claiming to divide the country in the name of religion, because a state with a Muslim majority preferred to join India. After that, today what we see that there is a dominant separatist narrative in Kashmir. It must have been very hard for Pakistan to create that kind of narrative. Today, in this webinar, we are going to uncover, we are going to deconstruct that mechanism, that infrastructure which Pakistan over the years created in Kashmir to popularize this separatist narrative. I have served in Kashmir as a field researcher for my research assignments, for my books also. And what I found was that Pakistan's infrastructure is a very complex, multi-layer and a very vibrant system. No? It has different facets, different dimensions and different components. For instance, there is this organization called Jamaat-e-Islami, which we joined last year, the government of India. Jamaat-e-Islami is a religious, it's a charity organization which has a strong presence in administration, government, politics, police, everywhere. But Jamaat-e-Islami believes in the ideology of Maulana Maududi, the so-called political Islam, which is much dreaded in today's world. Jamaat-e-Islami has been radicalizing people and it has spread its tentacles in all the state institutions. That is one arm of Pakistan's terror infrastructure in radicalizing people and creating the separatist narrative. Then there is media, which, you know, some of the media organizations, you know, the kind of news which they carry, it simply raises doubts that, you know, what purpose, what agenda they are serving. Some of the media organizations were even called by the National Investigative Agency for interviews, for interrogations in the terror financing cases. Then we have so-called activists, then we have religious clerics, Maulvis, you know, all different, these elements are the part of Pakistan's terror infrastructure. So I feel that if we want to address the problem, understand the problem, a very strictly kinetic approach, muscular approach is good. It's in a way, it's very important, but cannot be the only way to address the problem. We need to dissect and understand this terror infrastructure, the sinews of so-called proxy war, and then find out our roadmap, our strategic vision. So I first invite Sri Madhav Nalapat, sir, to share his views on the subject.
Abhinav, over you unmute, please. Is that okay?
Yeah, perfect.
We are able to hear you, sir.
No. Thank you. Look, mine is a view from the outside, and I must confess that, I've been to different locations like the Punjab, Kashmir, some other, for example, Maoist insurgency, and it is my view that if we have the will and a correct policy, such a situation can be brought under control in a fairly reasonable length of time. In the case of Kashmir, today's situation facing India is much better than the situation that faced Assamur in the 1990s. At that time, the United States, China, the Gulf countries, the European powers, every one of them was essentially hostile to the Indian position on Kashmir. They were very strongly tilted towards the Pakistan side. The economy was much less stronger than what it is now. And if I may say so, public consciousness also was not very high. And you saw things like the Pandit exodus take place, things like the destruction of houses of worship take place, things like the organized, terrorization of elements of the population that were moderate in the Kashmir Valley take place. And all this happened without, if I may say so, very much of resistance. Then you have bursts of kinetic action, and then long bursts of either inaction or, if I may say so, policies that have been improved. And as a consequence, this whole situation has been allowed to fester in a way that in Punjab was not allowed to happen when action was taken to the levels needed to succeed. Now, whether it be for any kind of a domestic insurgency which claims to have ethnic or religious roots, once you start a process of action, obviously the objective, the objective of that action has got to be to see through its conclusion. And if it's not seen to its conclusion and you end it somewhere, it becomes like an antibiotic. You take a limited course of an antibiotic, then you stop it, and then the organism becomes resistant, and then you have to bring in stronger and stronger doses of the antibiotic. So in Kashmir, most recently, we have seen this alignment with the PDP and the BJP. Personally, from the very start, I was a little taken aback by this kind of an alignment. And I don't think it has improved the ground situation at all in Kashmir. So the short point, frankly, is that in my view, we are administering antibiotics, then withdrawing before the disease is completely dealt with. And as a consequence, the organism gets resistant to those particular doses and needs different doses, stronger doses. And the first point. Second point, I think, you know, frankly, we need to move on a little bit. The reality is Pakistan no longer looks only at Kashmir for its covert operations against India. Pakistan no longer looks only at Kashmir for its campaign of subversion against India. It looks at the entire country. And it looks at the entire, what it regards as this natural hinterland in the entire country. And over the last, I would say, 10, 12 years, especially in the last 5 or 6 years, they have been focusing a lot on the entire country and not just Kashmir. Now, we have, you know, I mean, just now Abhinav was talking about the Jamaat-e-Islami Kashmir. The Jamaat-e-Islami Kashmir is independent of the Jamaat-e-Islami India. Now, why is that? I mean, why has that been allowed to happen? Why is it that you have so many individuals who have been inducted into all these services from the Jamaat-e-Islami? In fact, even into very sensitive organs of the state, such as the judiciary, the legislature, and of course the media, you have a very, I mean, you know, you have efforts at infiltrating them. And unfortunately, this has gone on, I don't say undetected, but I mean, not dealt with in the way it should be dealt with. And as I said, I repeat, when you give a course of antibiotics, you have to ensure the course is such that the entire organism is dealt with once and for all and is not allowed to recoup its energies and come back. Recoup either, for example, by suddenly going into a different mode, you know, going into the healing mode, quote unquote. It's usually not healing the people, it's usually healing the terror gangs. And it, so that is a point which I've seen in Kashmir, the zigs and zags of policy. And may I say that now we have to understand that this problem is now part of a wider problem in India, and which, unless it is tended properly, is going to lead to a very serious situation. So what we are seeing in Kashmir is now the microcosm of what we should not be, so we should not allow to be seen in any other part of the country. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Am I audible, Bhupendraji? Am I audible? Thank you very much, sir. Wonderful, amazing points, especially the one which you mentioned regarding those, I would say, an incomplete dosage of antibiotics. This is something which even I have come across, you know, I mean, and I feel that somehow our institutions or the people dealing with the situation, even they were not able to fully grasp the situation. Before moving on to the next speaker, I just, you know, would like to give one small example. So I was talking to one young police officer, one IPS cadet who has recently joined Kashmir. And after banning Jamaat-e-Islami, he told me that, why did you ban this organization? They're doing such a wonderful charity work. I was shocked, you know. And then I asked him, why do you say that? Then after that, he replied that when there is a law and order problem or a social unrest problem, these guys, you know, somehow, I mean, they are useful in controlling the situation. So actually, this is what has happened in Kashmir over the years. Such radical extremist organizations, they have blackmailed our institutions that, see, if you don't support us, if you don't engage us, we would, you know, will not cooperate with you, and the things will conflagrate, things will escalate into bigger levels of conflict. And we kind of, you know, went on giving into such forces without understanding the overall, this multi-layered infrastructure of terrorism in Kashmir. Well, anyways, It was just a little digression. Dr. Tarakartha, I would like to welcome you on behalf of Jivaranand Foundation. Dr. Tarakartha has been Randolph Jennings Fellow in a very prestigious think tank in DC. He has served in National Security Council Secretariat for years, and please share your views on the subject.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Yes.
Yes. Okay, I'm just going to take this slide to a slightly different level, the way we've seen it sitting where we are. You know, it's very strange. There are a couple of things which are really strange about this whole situation. One is that Pakistan is the only country in the world that has got terrorism on all its borders. I mean, it's amazing. They're operating in Afghanistan. They've got a virtual war there. They've got into Kashmir. They've got into Iran. Nobody says anything. It's the only country which has got its nationals in nearly every terrorist plot all over the world. Okay, that's another thing. Third is, it's also the only country that has been able to maintain this entire, about how many, 2 million residents in Gilgit-Baltistan, in a state of limbo. It's the only area in the whole world which is stateless. All this goes on. And nothing seems to happen, no sanctions, nothing. On the other hand, Pakistan is a great friend of everybody. It's needed in Afghanistan, it's needed by China, it's needed, it does all this for itself. And the final thing, which in part relates to what we are going to discuss here, is that it has, I mean, you have to admire these guys. They have been able to dominate the discussion here. I mean, not dominate, but I would say influence the narrative on Kashmir here to such an extent that now you can't see what Abhinav said. You can't see the actual aspects of what is going on because there's this huge narrative which is being imposed on you. So in, you know, these, for example, the fact that Pakistan occupied Kashmir after the 13th Amendment was withdrawn by the Prime Minister. The 13th Amendment virtually gave independence to POK. They did that quietly, quickly, and they pushed it through the Parliament. Suddenly, Islamabad realized and they withdrew it. Now, all the powers of the Prime Minister of Pakistan, of POK, or what we call POK, they call Azad Kashmir, rests with Islamabad. So, POK has far less, they are like a, I don't know what to say, they don't have even 1% of the powers which the Kashmir polity has, the rights, the government, the hundreds of things which go into making up a country which the Kashmir Valley has. Has this ever come out? It has never come out. Nobody even discusses it. So when we say we want to fight terrorism, I think we have to get the facts clear. We have to be able to push your narrative forward rather than just being defensive on this all the time and talking about things. So I'll just stop there. I think it's very important to get more information out on what is going on that side. And so many issues where they've been able to pull the wool over the international community's eyes. Whereas, I mean, anyone who does a web search, you'll get a huge amount of data on the Kashmir Valley problem. You will get nothing on POK. So I think I'll stop there.
Absolutely. Tara, you know, I certainly agree. And just, I would like to, you know, I would say just throw some light on this issue. Since you've been in DC, you know, for quite some time, there, especially the Jamaat-e-Islami proxies with their different organizations like Islamic Circle of North America, and you know, they have been doing a lot of lobbying in USCRIF and even in the State Department, getting a huge money from those guys and investing here in Kashmir's terror factories for a long time. Okay. Would you have to say something on that? No? I mean, what's the discourse, how it's in DC circles?
I would say within the government in the US, there is a very clear, very, very clear idea of what is going on. After all, they have the data. They have the eyes and ears able to, let's say, they're able to understand the situation. However, as you've seen, because of this U.S. Congress, there's certain people, you saw the session there, you saw the religious aspect, the Freedoms Act, all of this forces them to take positions which otherwise they know perfectly well is not true. And that's where, like you said, these organizations come in. They are on the ground and they are very, very agile. unfortunately not especially post Article 370, you had a flood of Pakistani people in coming into Washington, including the Prime Minister of POK, who spoke at various places. I mean, it's amazing the kind of narrative which they can put across, which ties into, I think there's somebody's mic is on. Can you hear me?
I can hear.
Yeah. So,
hello.
The narrative is about minority rights. The narrative is about religious issues. The narrative is about human rights issues. All of which is 100 times worse in Pakistan, but our version is not coming through. I don't want to say why or for what reason. I think the Delhi is comfortable in the fact that the State Department and others know what is going on. But I don't think that's enough, because even the US government faces pressures from various sides, from people who bring up these issues. But so far, I think in terms of what is on the ground, what has actually happened, we haven't done badly. I mean, increasingly, I think Pakistan is finding it difficult to get push its narrative, because it is so obviously strange. You have, I mean, I'm sorry to say this, you have a prime minister who calls Prime Minister Modi fascist, he compares him to Nazis. I mean, no one does this. Nobody does this in international, in diplomatic circles. So he's actually making it worse for himself. So in a way, I think our restraint is good. We've dealt with the government, but definitely we could do with much more, much, much more in not just disseminating information in Washington, but also within this country. There is just not enough information being given. Thank you.
It's trending genocide of minorities in India. I mean, it's really trending in the US circles and even on social media. And they so easily get away with such lies. You know, that's very impressive and surprising and shocking also. Major Gaurav Arya, now we would like to hear you. Before that, so my friends say that we have engaged Pakistan in a twin front warfare. One is with the security forces and other one is with Major Gaurav Arya. Major Gaurav Arya.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. I'll take about 10 minutes if that's okay with you.
Perfect. Please go.
Yes. It is my belief, and it has been my long held belief, for which people have actually, you know, come down heavily and said that no, that is not the case. But I stand firm in my belief that we don't have a Kashmir policy, so to say. It fluctuates very often. We do not have a permanent Kashmir policy. And I think we lay too much of emphasis on intellectual gymnastics. And I'll tell you what, there are too many pulls and pressures. There are too many people telling you what to do. There should be one direction, one policy, one understanding of the situation of Kashmir, the international pulls and pressures. I'll take you through a couple of points that I've very hurriedly jotted down here. And one is about radicalization that both the speakers have mentioned. And Professor Nalapath also mentioned about radicalization. And Abhinav, you also mentioned it. The thing is that I was in Anantnag, and we spoke about Jamaat-e-Islami earlier in this webinar. Spoke about Jamaat-e-Islami, and the thing is that they run about, there are around 500 madrasas in Anantnag district alone. Only in Anantnag there are 500 madrasas, and out of them 138 belong to Jamaat-e-Islami. Now, the Jamaat-e-Islami has been banned on the face of it, but these madrasas continue. They were locked up for a while. Many have started operations elsewhere. We must understand this. Secondly, I met a five-year-old girl, and I go to Kashmir very often, and I am in the habit of handing out chocolates and toffees to young kids, and a 5, 6, 7, 8-year-old girl, not very this thing. And I asked her, what do you do? So she said, I'm in school. And then this girl told me that when I grow up, I will have sons. And to these sons, I will teach the meaning of jihad. Now, I thought, how do you fight against a 5-year-old girl? The Indian Army cannot do that. The J&K police or the CRPF cannot do that. Our state apparatus is not equipped to fight a 5-year-old girl. And why has this been done by Pakistanis? They have used religious teachers and maulanas and maulvis from Deoband and Bareilly sect in Bareilly to go. So today, in many of the new madrasas and the new masjids in Kashmir, you will find a lot of maulvi from Bihar and from UP. There was a time when the sermons would be in Kashmiri or in Arabic. Today they happen in Urdu, and Urdu, which is typically of Western UP. I live in UP, so I can recognize and I can identify with the dialect here. Now, you know, before we go into this entire thing about the asymmetric warfare that is happening in Kashmir, I'll tell you what Pakistan has done very smartly. Now, the Indian Army has anti-infiltration grids along the line of control, which means that we have around a 750-760 kilometer line of control. We have fences there, we have patrols there, we have ambushes there, we have battalions there, which actually stop infiltration. This has ensured that Pakistani terrorists cannot infiltrate into India with the kind of impunity that they were used to earlier. Now, there was a time when I was there on the LOC, and there were no fences and there was nothing, and we'd just gotten used to this entire idea of infiltration happening from across Pakistan, and Pakistanis and especially Pakistani Punjabis and Pathans and all, they would come. Afghanis would come, and they would fight in Kashmir against the Indian Army and security forces. Now, there were thousands of them in Kashmir at that time. There was a time when there were 15 to 20,000 terrorists. Now, there aren't so many today. A handful of them, 200, 250, 300 by all counts. Now, the thing is that because of these anti-infiltration grids, what has happened is that Pakistanis can no longer infiltrate into India. Or if 100 try, only 2 or 3 or 5 make it. The rest cannot make it through. Now, what happens is that Pakistan has used internet very beautifully to radicalize an entire population. It has radicalized an entire population, which is why Adil Ahmed Dar, the person who carried out the Pulwama suicide bombings, is a Kashmiri. Riaz Naiku is a Kashmiri. Burhanwani is a Kashmiri. So, Samir Tiger, who was Samir Bhatt actually before they started calling him Samir Tiger, his fan club called him Samir Tiger. Now, all these are local Kashmiri terrorists. They are LTs, locally trained local terrorists. So, what has happened is that today, Pakistan has given them the ability to make IEDs, have used sniper rifles. Now, most of these applications, anybody can fire a gun. I can teach any civilian to fire a gun in 2 hours. It's not a big deal. The problem is the effectiveness with which they use IEDs, etc. This points to hardcore military training. Now, while there has been a kinetic response from the Indian Army and from the security agencies, I think what the Indian Army, and I have said it to the Army people also, that this entire thing of Sadbhavna, Army carries out a lot of, winning hearts and minds activities, like schools and, stuff like that, medical camps and all. This should be done. Yeah, this should be done. But I don't think this should be done by the Army, because the same Rashtra Rifles company commander, the youngster who's a major sub, he's leading a company in operations. In the morning, he's giving medicines and he's running schools. And at night, he's carrying out operations. That fear of the Indian Army has disappeared. During our time, there was no stone pelting. They would not dare stop a CRPF patrol. Today, they are pelting stones on Rashtra Rifles. There is a saying in English, familiarity breeds contempt. You see, I think the Indian Army has become too visible in Kashmir. This needs to go away. Also, we need to understand that if we think, in the hypothetical scenario that, we will give Kashmir to Pakistan, I'm saying a very, very hypothetical scenario, not in 1,000 years, but for the sake of academic discussion, we give Kashmir to Pakistan. If we think that they're going to stop at Kashmir, I'm sorry, we are very, very sadly mistaken. There are many people, so-called intellectuals in India, who say that, so much of blood is being shed. Just give them Kashmir. No, they'll ask for Delhi next, and they'll ask for Kerala, and they'll ask for Hyderabad, and they'll ask for Rajasthan and Manipur, and they'll ask for everything. This is also an ideological fight, and this is an existential battle between India and Pakistan. I'm saying these things so it's clear to the audience that, these things are actually happening. I can wrap it up in candy floss, and I can say nice things about it and make it sound really high-flying and intellectual, but that is not what the truth is. I go to Kashmir almost every month. It's only because of the lockdown that I'm locked up here in Noida. Otherwise, I go to Kashmir and I meet the people. And I'm fairly well aware of what is happening in Kashmir. Also, the fact that our policies have been wrong. You see, we have been trying to solve a problem in Kashmir that originates in Pakistan. Now, How silly is that? I mean, come to think of it, the problem originates in Pakistan. Pakistan started this problem. So what Pakistan does is, through the internet or through the Dubai route or through any other route, it trains these people. Who do these terrorists kill? They kill our soldiers. When they kill our soldiers, we lost a colonel in Handwara a month back. You see, we're losing soldiers every single day. And who does Pakistan lose? It loses some badly trained terrorist. That's all. So for Pakistan, it's a very, very cheap option. It hits morale. Once an officer or a jawan dies in the unit, it hits morale. Obviously, there is the thing that we want to get back. But is Pakistan paying the price? It's not paying any price at all. Unless there are deaths of Pakistani army soldiers and officers. You know, they kill three of our soldiers and officers. And we kill five terrorists and we say, oh, humne Uri ka badla le liya, ya fir humne Handwara ka, humne koi badla nahi liya. Colonel ke badle colonel, Havaldar ke badle Havaldar, JCO ke badle JCO. We must understand these, these nuances. You don't allow your uniformed personnel to die and, then start giving victory high fives to each other saying that we have killed a terrorist. That terrorist is from a madrasa, he has no value altogether, which is why Pakistan sent him in the first place. Let's be very clear. You have to hit the Pakistani army, you have to hit the Pakistani army hard. Then I also feel that this entire thing of, for a long time we were giving money to the Hurriyat. So I don't know what the exact amount is. Somebody said almost 100 crores a year was given. I don't know. But I know for sure that Gilani was treated like a king when he came to Delhi. He had police protection. He used to go to the top hospitals for treatment. He's got a house and Khidki extension in Delhi. And so Gilani is a multi-millionaire, a dollar multi-millionaire. And where did this money come from? Gilani has some meager pension. He was an MLA. So Gilani has some meager pension, which is less than 1 lakh rupees. So where did Gilani get all this money from? Sayyid Salahuddin's five sons. He's the head of the United Jihad Council and head of the Hizbul Mujahideen. His sons work for the JNK government. All five sons of Sayyid Salahuddin, they work for the government of India. And I mean the government of JNK. I beg your pardon. Gilani's children are very, very well settled. None of them do stone pelting. None of them are terrorists. This is something that we have not been able to pinpoint. Our kinetic measures in Kashmir are half-hearted. They are half-hearted. We are not sure of what we want to do. You know, this entire seminar circuit and this entire Aman Ki Asha circuit, this is surviving on the blood of our soldiers. Let us be very clear. Our soldiers are dying so that these circuits and these seminars that happen all over the world, in London and in Europe, other places, and in Washington, they can happen. I mean, we expect America to take our side. When we don't take our own side, why should we expect America to take our side? When we don't stand for ourselves, what are our diplomats going and doing all around the world saying that stand up for us, stand up for us? No, please stand up for yourself first. Pass a clear-cut message to Pakistan that terrorism in Kashmir will come at an extremely heavy cost, an extremely heavy cost. Pakistan must bleed. Once Pakistan starts bleeding, then you can have these de-radicalization programs in Kashmir. Unless you cut off the head of the monster, it's, you know, what we do, let me give, Dr. Tara has been there in the US and this problem is there in the US. So I would like to put a frame of reference here. We are like the people who ignore the drug lord, the top boss of the cartel, the drug cartel. We are very happy killing the drug pusher in the sidewalk, the street. You can kill 10,000 drug pushers. It will not stop. You have to get the boss of the cartel. Similarly, the boss of this cartel, the terror cartel, is the Pakistan army. Now, unless you make Pakistani army bleed, the problem is not Hafiz Saeed. The problem is not Sayyid Salahuddin. The problem is not Maulana Masood Azhar. The problem is General Qamar Javed Bajwa. Why do all of us lie to each other? That is my question. Why do we lie to each other? हम लोग एक दूसरे से झूठ क्यों बोलते हैं कि टेररिस्ट मार दिया ये मार दिया आप मारते रहो ना 100 साल तक मारते रहो पाकिस्तान हैज गॉट आई डोंट नो थाउजेंड्स एंड थाउजेंड्स ऑफ मदरसास इवन इफ वन स्टूडेंट कम्स फ्रॉम वन मदरसा इन वन ईयर दे विल बी एबल टू सस्टेन दिस टेररिज्म फॉर द नेक्स्ट आई एम टेलिंग यू 100 ईयर्स देयर आर मदरसास इनसाइड कश्मीर दे कैन सस्टेन इट फ्रॉम इनसाइड कश्मीर एंड देयर इज नथिंग दैट यू कैन डू अबाउट इट नाउ व्हाट वी नीड आर थ्री स्टेप्स नंबर वन अगेंस्ट द पाकिस्तान आर्मी Number two, massive diplomatic effort all over the world in not just exposing Pakistan, but the human rights situation inside Pakistan. Number three, information warfare. Our information warfare, our self-belief is very weak. We are always afraid of saying the wrong thing. You know, Will I be misconstrued? Will I be called a right winger? Will I be called a hardliner? Will I be called a bhakt? No, it's not about being a right winger or a bhakt or a hardliner. You're talking about your country. Let's be very, very sure. These people will not stop at Kashmir. They will want Punjab. They will want every part of India. You know, many of us who move in those circles make fun of Ghazwa-e Hind. They make fun of Ghazwa-e Hind. They say that, no, it's just a fool's dream. No. When enough people start believing in a fool's dream, that dream has every single chance of being or becoming real. The last thing that I want to say is, my CO, you know, Colonel Pathak, my CO, he used to say that to carry out any operation or any act or any mission, two things are required. Number one, you have to have capability. Secondly, you have to have intent. Today, Pakistan has the intent, it does not have the capability. The day Pakistan has both intent and capability, it's going to be a very, very sad day for India. We can only solve the problem in Kashmir by becoming proactive, by not shying away from taking hard calls. And hard calls, not just about 370 and 35A, active kinetic hard calls against Pakistan, directed not just towards terrorists. Terrorists only 10%, 90% towards the Pakistan army. Hit them inside Pakistan. Hit them in Sindh. Hit them in Karachi. Hit them in Balochistan. Hit them every time they try to hit us. And even when they are not hitting us, hit them again and again so they are on their knees. And when they are on their knees begging for mercy, hit them once again. That is how you pass a message. You pass a message by vertical escalation along the line of control, by horizontal escalation about the line, on the line of control. Today, and this is my last point, I'm sorry I've taken up too much time. Today, Chinese army has come inside Ladakh. Why? Because we are weaker in Ladakh. But there are so many places where we are stronger. Today, we want to negotiate. Why will the Chinese negotiate with you? They will negotiate once. Let the Chinese come inside Ladakh. Stop them. But in other places where you are stronger, go inside China. If they have sent 3,000-4,000 people, you send 10,000 people inside China, camp there, and then negotiate with China. Then you'll see that will be a fruitful negotiation. You know, somebody's come inside my house, it's sitting in my drawing room, and then I'm saying, I'm negotiating, please get out of my house. You should also be sitting inside his house. And then you can have a proper, fruitful negotiation. And that is all that I have to say. Thank you very much.
Major Gaurav Arya, thank you very much. It was such a wonderful insight. And I really agree with you on that part. Pakistan having no losses. These days it is said that they don't even need terrorists from Pakistan. They are local Kashmiri boys and they get that Darra Khel AK-47 which comes in like 10, 27,000, 25,000. You know, that, so it's just an expenditure of 25,000, 30,000. That's it. You know, that's what Pakistan needs to do. And once a local terrorist is killed, that generates alienation, that generates frustration, resentment against us. So for them, it's just every way, it's a game for them. Hello, can you hear me? Yeah. And you mentioned about the seminar circuit. Okay, that's a very interesting thing because, you know, sometimes like when we look back, I feel that we sent umpteen number of interlocutors, you know, Kashmir experts and like, you know, people went to go and talk to the people over there. But, you know, no one pointed about the extreme levels of radicalization, the activities of Ahle Hadith sect, the activities of Jamaat-e-Islami. What was going on in Kashmir? Like there was this scheme called Rehbar Talim scheme. The entire Jamaat-e-Islami cadres, their sympathizers, they were recruited as teachers in the government services. And those who came on the recommendations of Jamaat-e-Islami, they shared a part of their salary, which went into terror funding, which went into separatist narrative.
Absolutely. If I may make a point here, Abhinav.
Yes.
See, हम लोग कोई काम दिल से नहीं करते. हम किसी की भलाई करते हैं वो दिल से नहीं करते, किसी को डंडा मारते हैं वो दिल से नहीं करते. You see, terrorists want to surrender, he surrenders. After 5 years, he'll again go back to being a terrorist. I mean, is this some kind of a joke that is going on in Kashmir? What surrender? And it does not take, as I said, it takes 2 hours to train a civilian to fire a gun. You just aim and pull the trigger and spray it like a water hose and some soldier dies. So, you see, you spoke about radicalization. This is becoming such a big problem and we are moving around like headless chicken saying, let us do this. Sadbhavna kar dete hain, school mein padha dete hain, ye sab, you do whatever you wish to do. But in the end, the outward appearance of the Indian state has to be absolutely uncompromising. The appearance of the Indian state is that there is a famous chopai from Ramayana, and the last line of the chopai is bhayven hoina pri. There is no friendship without fear. this element of fear should be very potent. It should be very visible. It should be in your face. Whether it is the Hurriyat Conference, whether it is the Pakistani army, whether it is the Hizbul Mujahideen or any other terror group. This feeling of stark terror, this feeling, Gilani should know that there can be a knock at his door at 2 o'clock in the morning and somebody will come and talk to him. You cannot fight it like this. We are you're fighting at one level and they are fighting at another level altogether. Today we are fighting with our hands tied behind our backs. I don't understand what kind of a fight is this where we lose soldiers. Today, in trying to minimize civilian casualties, which we should do anyway because they are our people. And, you know, that is not something that any other army will do. We should do it. At the same time, what we should understand is that we cannot take our own casualties. Somebody has to pay a price for this. And I feel very bad and I'm sorry I'm making this statement here in public. You know, I met a couple of Kashmiri friends on a flight. And I said, "Aap Srinagar kyun ja rahe hain?" So he says, "Main apne doston se milne ja raha hoon." And I was going to Kashmir. Hum apne doston se milne ja rahe hain. So they were going to Kashmir to meet family and friends. I said, when I go to meet my friends, I go to the bloody National War Memorial to meet my friends. Because their names are written there. And this is what these people have done. They are killing our soldiers in Kashmir and we are doing nothing. And all this thing about this seminar circuit and all these things about, you know, isse baat kar lo, usse baat kar lo, Gilani ko paise de do. He will take our side. Why do we want Gilani to take our side in the first place? I have never understood. That when push comes to shove, Gilani will. Why? Put Gilani in jail in Kerala or in Andaman somewhere for the rest of his life. End of story. Who's Gilani? We are a nuclear power. This is India, boss. Second, highest population in the world. $3 trillion. Humse kaun puchne wala hai? Humse log isliye puchte hain kyunki hum sawab jawab bahut dete hain hum log logon ko. Anybody asks us a question, we are willing to go anywhere and we want to answer. This whole thing about intellectualizing this conflict in Kashmir, that no, this no. If you've done rights violations, punish the people who do rights violations in Kashmir. Don't tom-tom it from every street. This is an internal family matter. Keep it inside. And let people see the hammer. And that hammer is the Indian army. You know, let Pakistanis see the hammer. You have army, navy and air force. Ke liye Republic Day ki parade ke liye humne banayi hai fauji. Which day do we have these forces? If not to teach Pakistan a lesson. They have tied us in Kashmir. And one more thing I want to say. This is all China is doing, you see. So we keep on looking towards the north. We keep on looking towards Punjab, ki Khalistan na ho jai. We keep on looking towards line of control, ki infiltration na ho jai. We keep on looking towards Kashmir, ki terrorism na ho jai. We keep on looking towards northeast, ki wahan pe insurgency na ho jai. We keep on looking towards Siachen Glacier, Operation Meghdoot, ki wahan se Pakistani aake Siachen na le le. And we forget that the main action is happening down south. It is the sea routes. China has kept you busy in the north. And China will keep on making you busy in the north. Because they want to strengthen their navy, the PLA navy, and they want because they don't want India stopping their sea routes. So idea is that in the national level, policy level, we must say it as it is. I mean, diplomats can say it and sugarcoat it, but amongst ourselves, we should not lie.
To Professor Madhav Nalapat, sir. Madhav Nalapat, sir, can you hear me?
Yes, I know. I just want to say that I'm you know, I fully agree with Major Arya, and you know, he was on the field, he is in the front line, and you need that kind of experience. Now, I simply want to say that you look back at our own history, and we are a country where, frankly, the system does not ever look at history, or when it looks at history, it never understands it. It's like the Bourbons. The Bourbons never understood the history. Now look at Kashmir in the 1990s. The back of that particular insurgency was broken when local Kashmiris who were in the terror organizations took up arms against their former terrorist colleagues because they said these are Afghans, these are Pashtuns, these are Punjabis, they are oppressing the Kashmiri people. Now what happened to those people? Many of them were shot dead. Some of them were sent to jail. What happened in the Punjab? The policemen whose families were butchered, and you had all kinds of that kind of thing going on. And these policemen, of course, you know, took kinetic action, and they ensured that the back of the Khalistan terrorist movement was broken in the Punjab. And what happened? You know, friends of so many of our politicians who are in California, who are in London, who are in Canada. Oh my God! Look at what has happened. so many people. How can these people be allowed to just roam around? And so many of these policemen were subjected to trials lasting decades. I mean, look at the lessons they learned from IPKF. Never get people, never put boots on the ground. What happened to the IPKF? You had a president, Premadasa, who funded the LTTE, armed the LTTE, and motivated them in plain sight with India doing nothing. And then you had the IPKF coming back to Chennai, where they were given a hot, very unpleasant and undeserved, you know, welcome. Now, you would have known that this welcome was being prepared. You would have known that, you know, Chennai was the wrong place for them to come landing in. But you allowed that to happen. I mean, and you pulled them out without any kind of second thought. And you said, okay, this man Premadasa, who is viscerally anti-Indian, and yes, we'll obey him. I mean, for God's sake, what kind of a power are you acting like? Are you acting like Mauritius or acting like India? So I look, and you know, you have raised the point about China. I quite agree. Let me tell you very clearly, China is now intimately networked with Pakistan. It's not an accident that ISI officers are active in the CMC, active in the, you know, in Beijing military headquarters, active in Chengdu, and possibly active at even tactical levels as well. The reality is this integration has taken place. And recently we have had some events on the border, and I think we are very happy that a major general came and not, you know, some colonel or some, I don't know, some lower level officer. I mean, that's fine. But the reality is, what are the facts on the ground? Till now, the Indian people have not been told the facts on the ground. And I agree with Gaurav. The reality is, if they have occupied territory, we occupy territory, and then we negotiate. In my case, I can tell you, I go to Beijing a lot. I go to Washington a lot. The Chinese know I want a strong security alliance with the United States. I put it on the table openly. And I don't think, frankly, that, you know, that, I mean, the fact is, the Chinese will respect strength. They will respect honesty, and you know, they will give you a lot of stuff, and if you fall for it, they'll smile at you and they'll have contempt for you. So the reality is today, what is happening with Pakistan, with China, I am beginning to worry if there is now coordinated actions taking place between the two sides, between tactical levels in the two sides. So, I mean, I know the only point I wanted to make. When is our system ever going to learn from history the right lessons? About IPKF, the IPKF was not the problem. The problem was the stab in the back by Premadasa that we did nothing for, and this problem was the very dishonorable way in which some politicians treated the IPKF, and the very dishonorable way in which we treated the soldiers of IPKF as though they were a defeated army, which they were not. And this has been happening in Kashmir over and over again with the terrorists who came to our side and were sent to the wolves, with the brave Punjab police officers and those who helped the police, who were serially knocked out and who were, you know, basically a large number of NGOs turned up. The last point I want to make, I mean, in this, I'm sorry. I mean, we are talking about information technology. We are talking about, you know, about at least in the sphere of knowledge, we should have escalation dominance. There are a few, if you look at Silicon Valley, you'll see a few more Indian brains than Pakistani. I mean, well, and that's not accidental. Many more Indian brains. The reality is, frankly, our civil society is not in the picture by the civil service. And the only people who are in the picture are, frankly, people who are servants of the civil service from civil society, or who are clones of the civil service in terms of their mindset. You're talking about seminars and conferences. Who do you think funds these seminars and conferences? Whom do you think chooses the people at these seminars and conferences? I'm happy not in my university. We are a private university. We have kept our distance from governments all through. And I think we have kept our nationalism also going all through. But I simply want to say, this is a problem created by our own lack of action. It is not action by Pakistan. It is inaction by India. And therefore, I want to say, I'm delighted that you have people like Gaurav speaking out. He had to speak out only when he left and joined the private sector organization. if he goes back to government, I think you'll see, you know, Major Gaurav Arya talking about Sadbhavna in the next 6 months. Thank you.
Thank you, Madhav sir. I'm coming back to you, Dr. Thara. Mm-hmm. Madhav sir, you raised a point on well-coordinated action. So I would like to just, you know, bring your attention to this new factor in Kashmir scenario now. Especially after the Americans all said to leave Afghanistan, Turkey, as we know, so in the recent past has become very active on Kashmir and even in its outreach to the Muslims of the subcontinent. And as far as when I talk to my friends, I talk to some analysts in the Middle East also, they say that like Turkey is making massive outreach to Indian Muslim community through social media and especially very active on Kashmir. They have come out with these new technology in drones, especially their two drones, Bayraktar drones and Anka S, which were very successful in Syria against the Russians and the Syrian Arab army. Very likely, it's pretty much possible that after the Americans leave, Turkey may get involved strongly in Afghanistan with their Pakistani friends, and they are likely to train Kashmiri terrorists, you know, not only in terms of logistics or other training, but drone technology, cyber warfare, information warfare, and financing also. So what do you have to say about this aspect, this new player?
Abhinav, every day that Erdogan continues in power is a menace to civilized society. I want to say, frankly, I would like to see India as a platform for the manufacture of high-performance United States defense assets, such as, for example, the F-35. The F-35 system is moved from Turkey. Turkey, by the way, has a far better aerospace sector than India does, for reasons of policy, frankly. Not Erdogan, but pre-Erdogan. Now, why they're not going to move to India? Why? Because they moved because Turkey went in for S-400. We have gone in for S-400. Now, the reality of the situation is, once that system is installed in India, once you have certain 5G systems operating in India, you are foreclosing the door to any kind of in-depth security cooperation with the United States. So, you know, if you look at things in silos, and you talk about, for example, I don't know, I've heard this, strategic autonomy, strategic sovereignty. I mean, a country which imports 85% of its essential defense equipment talks about strategic autonomy and strategic sovereignty. I mean, give me a break. So I want to say very clearly, we have to look at a holistic picture. I would like to see a robust security relationship with the Quad in the Indo-Pacific. I'd like to see radar stations operate in the Indo-Pacific that can track any kind, even a fishing boat from China or from Pakistan can be tracked by them. This can only happen if we join hands, and we cannot join hands if we forget the fact that today you have a Sino-Russian alliance. And you know what has happened in the border, I don't know. I'm beginning to wonder seriously whether we got information from a very good friend of a long time that the Chinese will not cross the border. They have been massing on the border for quite some time, for weeks. And as far as I know, I don't think there was a response to the Indian side. Did somebody tell us they are not going to cross? I mean, I would like to find out. The reality is, this government is as secretive as the previous government. The previous government failed because of its secrecy. For heaven's sake, you know, Dr. Karta, you're talking all these things. You know, you have been in the system in and out. Why is it that information is not shared with the public? Why is it that fake information is not fought with real news? And why is it that you have such inbred, you know, methods of dealing with issues? The civil society in India is 1,000 times stronger than Pakistan's, 10 times stronger than China's. But you are basically trusting that 1% or 1% of it, which you know will follow in your footsteps very faithfully.
Thank you, Professor. Dr. Tara Karta, what do you have to say?
Okay, doctor. First things to Dr. Nalapat. I'm not in government anymore, so don't ask me. No, but I was just flagging this yesterday. I was looking at MEA's information page on Jammu and Kashmir. It's been last updated in 2002. It's amazing. I mean, there are embassies in Afghanistan. The pages are not updated. on what the benefits that we are giving Afghanistan not updated. So yes, I 100% agree with you. We are very, very poor, extremely poor at providing the right information and putting it out there. Particularly, for example, you know, if I were, for example, to get the statistics on Baloch, you know, human rights violations and put it out there, can we do that? We don't do that. So in that, Major Gaurav Arya, I would agree with you. But the problem is, I'll tell you, rhetoric is easy. Now you see how this particular interaction has moved. Instead of, we were supposed to discuss PAK infrastructure of terrorism in POK. We are now discussing Kashmir. There is no information on POK. That is why I go on saying again and again, we are constantly criticizing ourselves, which is a good thing. We are constantly talking about solutions, Kashmir, Kashmir. Tell me about POK. Do you know that why isn't there a single terrorist from Gilgit-Baltistan who has ever come here? Why is it that POK has been asking for roads into Kashmir since when? Do we give, I agree with Mr. Nalapat, we are not given enough publicity to the fact that POK themselves want access to Kashmir. And these guys don't let them. In your so-called peace negotiations, the Pakistani side will never, ever let you talk about Gilgit-Baltistan. Why have we agreed to that? In so many governments, not this government, this government fortunately has done much better. The previous governments have just not refused, have just taken that request value. So every single time, even in this interaction, we are talking about our side of Kashmir. For heaven's sake, talk about what they are doing. You know, and second thing, it's very easy. Now, unlike Major Arya, I'm not a television person, so I don't know how beautifully he puts it. I can't put it as well. But please remember, there is a lot of rubbish going on in Pakistan. I wouldn't be in Pakistan for anything. They've got the Financial Action Task Force breathing down their neck. It is a very, very, very intrusive process. Number two, they've got a Pashtun resistance movement. It's entirely peaceful. And it's extremely wide. It is not just in Pashtun lands. It is across in Karachi, everywhere. Baloch never comes on media, but it is going on. Please believe me, it is going on all the time. You will not get those reports. So there is a lot which is going on. And I mean, separately from this, please separately, if the Indian intelligence does something, it's not something that anybody is ever going to talk about. So it's one problem for intelligence agencies is that you can't trumpet your successes. But please believe me, Pakistan is not in a good place. It is in a very, very, very terrible situation right now. And that is partly the reason why the number of terrorists coming from Pakistan has reduced. It is becoming difficult for them. But this is where I am really, really apprehensive, is that from, I think, 42 camps, it's come down to about 18, between 18 and 20, which is in POK. But according to the UN report, there are about 10,000 Pakistanis in Afghanistan. What do I do about those? You know, so these guys have been playing this. When I say these guys, please let me. Now, this is not a seminar subject. This is the reality. What we are dealing with is a very, very small part of the Pakistani establishment. It's not the Pakistani people. The Pakistani politicians, many of them want peace with India for their own reasons, for their own political reasons, but that's okay. So even within the establishment, within the bureaucracy, it is this small group, and that is the group we need to target. And that is the group which the international community needs to take action against. These people are extremely dangerous, but they are also very good. They are very, very good with this kind of war and this kind of, you know, movement from which probably increases after Balakot into Afghanistan is going to be very dangerous. So again, I would appeal to everybody on this panel, even outside it, those who are listening, please focus on what's going on in Gilgit-Baltistan and POK. Don't just keep half this thing of what show Kashmir policy should be. The government knows pretty well. They're not the best. It's not easy. But I would say this government has done 100 times more than what has been done earlier. People have been put under detention, not the best thing, but it had to be done, they did it. So we now, what remains is for people who go on TV to dominate the narrative. Tell them things like the fact that, I'll tell you one simple line, I beg of you, please keep saying this. Pakistan army knows extremely well they can never take Kashmir. They know that, right? So what are they using the Kashmiris for? They are using the Kashmiris as gun fodder. Now that one single message needs to be pushed out. I don't see that happening. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Tara. You mentioned about the POK and Gilgit-Baltistan. I would just like to mention that I recently wrote a paper on China and Pakistan's demographic engineering in POK and Gilgit-Baltistan. South Asia Democratic Forum, that's a European think tank, they published it. And I, in my limited capacity, I tried to highlight all these things. This is a question, to all the speakers. I mean, not exactly a question, but I would just like to you to share your thoughts. Over the last few days, some think tanks and very eminent voices have been arguing that India should be engaging Taliban, for its security and strategic interest in Kashmir and all that. Well, frankly speaking, personally, I don't see any reason to engage with Taliban, because if Americans learn to engage with Hezbollah, then someday we might think about engaging Taliban. What do you think, in your opinion, especially the arrival of Taliban regime ascendance will be very detrimental to our Kashmir conflict? So how we should be going about it? I mean, all of you.
I think Professor Nalapath can start.
Gaurav, as I said, he's got the ground situation. I have only had the privilege of occasionally meeting people in Kashmir during the 1990s mostly, and in Punjab during the 1980s, and I can only say I'm awed at the kind of dedication that they showed. And above all, let me say, in the Punjab, for example, I had gone multiple times. There was only one time in which one Khalistani group actually entered a particular location where I was, and they did certain things which I don't want to repeat now. But I simply want to say that they also put up a Khalistani flag. What they did, I don't want to repeat, except that it was an extremely unfortunate, and it left a lot of very, very, very unhappy people. That Khalistani flag, almost as soon as they disappeared from the horizon, the Sikhs in the village, who are an overwhelming majority, they tore down that flag. And from that time, I realized Khalistan is never, never, ever going to succeed. And this is the point. The people have got to be with you, and in Kashmir, the people are with you. But why is it that the media, the government, and foreign governments, diplomats, they only concentrate on this 10 or 15%? At one time it was 1%, now it may be 15% of Wahhabis in the population in the valley. 85% are completely non-Wahhabi. When I saw that in the Punjab, I felt this war, 100% India is going to win, and India did win. But the point is, it is very important for us to understand who our people are. What I like about Major Arya's presentation, he knows who our people are. And I'm sorry to say, a lot of money has been spent on the Maoists, a lot of money has been spent on the Hurriyat, a lot of money has been spent on a lot of very bad causes. And there are people who have done that, and I don't think anybody has been held accountable for that. Oh, it's a mistake. Oh, okay, they changed their mind. I remember Oli, at one time he was about to be removed as the Prime Minister of Nepal. I think he came running to India, and lo and behold, suddenly many people said, Oli, he has transformed. He is a Bhakta of India now. And frankly, I think that helped Oli get a reprieve. I know for a fact, for example, now the Prime Minister Rajapaksa, there was a lot of tension between him and India. And one of the factors in the Sri Lankan electorate was that if he is brought back, there'll be tensions with India. Dr. Swami and myself, we invited him. He's an old friend, both him and his brother. And we invited him to India. And of course, there was a lot of effort to stop that. But I am happy to say Prime Minister Modi decided to disregard that and had a long, hour-long meeting with the former President Rajapaksa against the advice of many of his people. And that was such a helpful thing. He went back, it helped him tell the Sri Lankan voter, look, is not going to lead to war with India if I am elected. And secondly, he genuinely is happy. He genuinely feels in Prime Minister Modi he has a friend who he has. So let me only say, I have long been saying right from 2013 onwards, 2012, Modi should be Modi and ensure that you have a Modified government. I'm sorry, I've seen very little of that in Modi 1.0. I'm seeing a little more of that in Modi 2.4. But I want to go back to this point, frankly, about, you know, about China. And I think China and POK, yes, I agree about POK. You know, I'm not a military man, but I've written some articles as to how India can take over POK. And I'm very clear that unless we take over POK, we are not going to be a significant player on the geopolitical stage. If we can't even take back POK from a failing power like Pakistan, I mean, Tara Karta is talking about Pakistan melting down. Some of us, Tara, I mean, you may not be reading that, have been saying that the state is in meltdown and that we should ensure that moral and diplomatic support, of course not violence, but moral and diplomatic support should be given to the Baloch, to the Sindhis, to the Muhajirs, to the moderate Punjabis, and to the Pashtuns. The Pashtuns, for example, should have the Durand line removed. It is unfair to have the Durand line.
Absolutely.
Okay, government need not say it. NGOs can say it. Why is it that even NGOs are not allowed to say it? You have laws in India that if you say something like that, any busybody can file a postal card and get you in trouble through an FIR. You'll have some constable in police and who will then file an FIR and summon you here and summon you there. Have you checked our laws, Tara? Please check them. You know, please check the First Amendment in the United States and the First Amendment in India and the difference. So I simply want to say we have to create a culture of transparency. We have to create a culture of debate and we have to brutally look at our own problems. Because as we say in an aircraft, when you fly in an aircraft and you have some problem in the aircraft, the oxygen mask comes down. Before you give the oxygen mask to the infant, wear it yourself. So let's put on our own oxygen. And I'm glad that you've got people like Gaurav who have breathed that oxygen clearly. I'm sorry, I'm not able to see too much of it in many other parts of Delhi.
Thank you, Professor Narpal. Thank you very much. Really amazing insights. Today, we also have Dr. Gautam Sen and Sahaya sir with us. You know, Dr. Gautam Sen, since you have been working in the security affairs for long, you have amazing strategic insights. Would you like to share your views on the subject?
Don't you think that the participants who have the question take that first and then we come in?
Questions will be taking afterwards, I think, you know, because there are too many questions.
Okay, 2-3 questions. Well, it's a privilege to have Professor Nalpat once again, old friend. And the issue is, I see it from a very different perspective. The melody is that in India, we have always administered to govern and not governed to administer. That's the point number one. As a theory person, terrorism is the darker side of globalization. And today you are seeing a deglobalization taking place. We can cry our heart out to say what went wrong in Jammu and Kashmir. Today, I think it is Dr. Karta who said that the aim of the seminar was supposed to be dissecting Pakistan's terror infrastructure. And we ended up doing the same thing, discussing Jammu and Kashmir.
Absolutely. See,
we are not concentrating on the main issue. How do we make ourselves understand that whether we are talking geopolitically, whether we are talking from the information perspective, whether we are talking on the decision-making system, and whether we are talking about dissemination of information, they all must concentrate on that specific area. How do we deactivate the terror infrastructure which is there in Pakistan? Bhagavatam. That's my point one. Now, first melody, I also had a small, what you call, experience of working with the NSCS for about a year or so, year and a half. One of the biggest problem with our system is that it is opaque to the core. They work in silos. One section does not talk to the other section. Even at the top, they don't exchange ideas. And policies is an outcome of opportunities and resources. The issue is that are the opportunities opportune and the resources adequate? Resources will never be fully adequate. It will be always short of it. But you can do it by ensuring that the resources are properly utilized. What is the sense of having commission reports and studies done, which is not even discussed in public? I'm not saying that you are going to give out your intent. Intent is something which you always keep to yourself. But I'm sure that you can make it transparent that the studies are available to the people. It will rot in a vault till the time it doesn't become what you call absolutely null and void. To give you an idea of this opaqueness, the issue is that if terrorism is to be tackled and terrorist infrastructure is to be dismantled, then we have to understand the genesis of terrorism. Terrorism is an outcome of a crisis of identity. War, conflict, violence, separatism, these are all cultural phenomena. They have no technical solution. We have to deal with it at a cultural and a civilizational perspective. What we are doing here is we are narrating very well what went wrong. We are not giving as to what we must do to undo what went wrong. Therefore, what can we do? As President Albert said, a very interesting thing, and I think I wrote it down, that this complete jargonization of a variety of labels, one of them he noted was strategic autonomy. It is a, I don't want to use a four-letter word, it's an absolute bullshit, if I may say so. What is strategic autonomy without power? You cannot have strategic autonomy without power. And for that, for the first time, as he also noted, that we have had a discussion with the Chinese at a technical level to begin with for the first time a few days back. And obviously, the technical report is different and the MEA report is totally different. Who is going to bridge the gap between the realm of ideas and the domain of public policy making? Obviously, the intellectuals, the public intellectuals, the non-vertical governmental organizations and non-governmental people have to come in a very big way, provided. But then there's a catch-22. Who supports them? If you take the money from an organization which is wedded to secrecy, wedded to opaqueness, it's not going to reach anywhere. I'm sorry to say that when we don't have a defense policy so far of India, how are we going to have a Kashmir policy of India? You know, it's very interesting that in 19, I think it was Narasimha Rao when he was the prime minister, he made a statement in the parliament that a charge has been labeled that we don't have a defense policy. And he said, Mr. Speaker, sir, that's a very unusual statement. Yes, true, we do not have a piece of paper which says what is our defense policy, but we have got guidelines. And those guidelines are followed very robustly. It's an anonymous thing, unwritten thing. We don't even have an India's defense policy so far written down. how do you expect a person who is doing strategic analysis to do any strategic analysis in the absence of a defense policy or strategic policy? You look at, there are every country, the smallest country in the world, have published white papers on their strategic policy. They don't say how they are going to achieve it, but they do say that this is our strategic policy, strategic outlook, strategic narrative, so that others can chip in. Now, this is what is going wrong. Though Gaurav is absolutely dot on the line, eye for an eye. Yes, we have to send a message, but how do you send a message when the people who are going to decide do not have the capacity to take a decision to send that message, if I may ask? I think I'll stop here, because we can keep on talking till cows come home. It's not going to solve it till the time people are not decisive, first in the government. And last thing is, I said a very cruel thing one day to the person who is in charge of the NSIV. I said, you are surrounded by very intelligent, experienced domain experts who are hardly educated. Now, this is a very cruel statement to make. But that's a fact, because every domain expert looks at it through his domain. Gaurav is looking at it through the media. But the Nalpat is looking from geopolitics. And there is no relationship between the two, because the silos are different. And silos are operating in isolation. We have to create a system by which this isolationism is given way. In my alma mater, when we were graduate students, the first dictum was that my problem is everybody's problem, and everybody's problem is also my problem. Okay? That's the transparency. Here, we have a bunch of people who will take ideas from others, will not quote it from where the ideas have come, and they like to be on top of it by saying, this idea was mine. This thing has to go. And I think I'll stop here. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Singh. Thank you. It's really, I can relate to this, actually. You know, this is a major problem. You know, since I was in States, and you know, even like at Cornell, the CIA people used to come and recruit there, the domain experts. And you know, there was some kind of an interaction and a bridge between the experts, academia, public policy professionals, and the government. So it was not just a one-way business of taking ideas and presenting it in some other names. Hi, sir. Thank you very much for joining, sir. Sir, would you like to say something? Since you've been in the government, you've been with Kashmir for years. Hello?
Abhinav, I don't think Sahi sir is able to speak. I don't see his microphone.
Okay. So,
no, he is there.
He's there, but is he able to speak? Because I don't
see. I think he's speaking. Yeah.
Yeah. Fine. Sorry.
Hello.
Is he able to use? Yes, I think I see his microphone. Sir, sir, you can speak, sir.
I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. We are able to hear you now, sir. Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's not a very unfamiliar situation for me, because when I was in service, I didn't have a face and a name, much less a voice. So I was almost there today. I had a face there, but no voice. Let me begin by saying that thank you very much, Abhinav, for inviting me to join this webinar, which is a new experience for me. I must compliment you and your new think tank for your first such seminar, and which I'm sure is going to be the beginning of a long career in strategic organizing, a strategic discussion, etc. I've known Abhinav for the last few years, and it was more by accident than design. And have had the pleasure of working with him on a number of projects and study papers. And I see a very bright future for him in this world of study. And I can see that during a very short time, you have managed to get some of the brightest and the most established brains in the field. It was a delight listening to Narpat Sahib once again, and Gautam, my dear friend, even though he has moved from Pune to Bangalore, which is a much cooler city, the fire is still there, burning very hard. It was good to see you, Gautam. We miss you in Delhi. It was also a great pleasure of listening to the young, dynamic former army of Arya and Dr. Tara. I don't know how I missed her during my service days, but then, of course, the later part of my service, I was not a very frequent visitor to the NSAB. My association with Kashmir actually goes back to 1993 when I was posted there as Commissioner Government of India in Jammu, based in Jammu, and responsibilities in the valley as well as in Punjab. And that was quite a bit on the plate. Those were the worst days of militancy, and I Major Arya mentioned about stopping somewhere on the road and giving away chocolates and coffee to young children. I also had done that in 1993 at Sopo, just after crossing the bridge. I had stopped there and I got my security people that put shocked and believe. But then that was long time back. And since then, I have seen Kashmir go through different phases. A part of it has been covered during the interaction this morning. Can you hear? Is the voice still coming or I'm gone?
No, it's coming. It's coming, sir.
Hello.
It's coming. We can hear, sir.
I think the audio is low.
No, we can hear, sir. It's coming. The voice
is the audio there?
We are able to hear you loud and clear, sir. Please, carry on.
Audio is coming?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. It's coming, you. Sir.
Thank you very much. There must be, I'm not very tech savvy, so there must be some problem on my side of the equipment connection. I can go on discussing Kashmir for hours and end, but I don't wish to do that. Because since 1993, when I began my association, more by accident, kind of sign, I've seen Kashmir go through virtually every phase of it, fight against militancy. Arrival of so-called foreign militants after 1995, starting with the Doda Kishtwar area, then the two elections, the parliamentary elections and the state assembly elections, and you name it. The dialogue with Pakistan, the Vajpayee-Musharraf dialogue, intelligence interactions, and January 2004 joint statement, and you name it. So there is so much that has happened over the years that. I find it extremely difficult to sort of encapsulate it into a few minutes, but maybe on occasions like these or on bilateral basis, we can discuss different parts. What I want start comparing to which the army security forces were very fond of using in the mid-1990s, something which I don't subscribe to as a measure of the so-called dominance of the security forces. But the fact of the matter is that today we are in pure security parameters in a much stronger, much better position in Kashmir. As an aside, let me narrate that, you know, as we drive from Sopore to Kupwara, and you are about to reach that key intersection from where to the left you turn to Kandhar, and to the right you go to the Div headquarters, the market and all that. And down the valley, the beautiful river and the official quarters. I still vividly remember that. One of the most beautiful sceneries of that particular tribe. When we had information, even when we had specific information that X number of terrorists are there up on the mountain to the right hand side, very tough terrain to climb up there and to take them on, we could not do that. Today, and that's the time when the government used to claim that the backbone of militancy has been broken and militants are on the run for crime out loud in 1995. And neither of the two was true at that stage. But today, if I were to say that the backbone of militancy has been broken and militants don't have a place to hide, a secure place to hide, I think it would be a fair assessment of where we are in terms of the security dynamic. On the diplomatic front, also, blow by blow, Narpachi has given a very detailed account of where we are, where we are. Match that is where we were in the early 1990s, and how much effort has gone into that. We have traveled the distance substantially. There was, I think, Taraji raised the point about Pakistan, favorite of every power, be it the Americans or the Chinese and all that. True and perhaps not true, depending on how you look at the dynamics of geopolitics in the regional and the larger context of the bilateral, regional, and larger context. We haven't done too badly there also. We have more friends standing up with and for me, for us, than we ever had. I recall when someone mentioned about the, I think the discussion was to be about PUK camp infrastructure. I recall that when I first time plotted the known terrorist camps in PUK in 1996-97, there were 121 of them, and these camps were of different types. When you talk about camps, you know, you start with the training camps, the base camps, the logistics, they bring the logistics into them, the launching camps, the holding camps, and more. There are three, four types of them. There are 121 of them, and significantly, each one of them was within 1 kilometer to 3 kilometers from a known position of the park rangers. Now, this kind of concrete, verifiable information was not acceptable by the world community. today, the situation is different. So, the camps have moved away. They are not able to keep, to maintain or sustain those camps there because of the collar courts and the surgical strikes and what have you. The capacity to hit back has vastly improved. Our capacity to decide to hit back, and that is more important because the second part of it, the execution, totally depends on the armed forces, which they have come admirably. So it's not that bad there also. But if we are looking at others to fight our war, that's hugely mistaken. There is no global war against terrorism, nor is there any war against global terrorism. And this is in spite of the fact that the entire world community is united on both, either of the two formulations that you talk about, but you prefer to accept global war against terrorism or war against global terrorism. And there is a significant difference between the two formulations. But we are all agreed on that part. No one is going to fight global war, and you've got to fight it yourself. But this can go on. I feel extremely happy that the event has taken place, and so many brilliant brains have encouraged Abhinav on this path, on this journey, which is going to be very exciting and not always full of roses. So those who have traversed through this know it is not easy, but you've got to stand there and fight for yourself. I wish you all good luck, and thank you very much for having me and patiently listening. Goodbye.
Thank you very much, Sahai sir, for the wonderful insights. I absolutely agree that today we have much better capabilities in terms of like in counterinsurgency operations and also the diplomatic heft. Since I work in Kashmir, so I've seen those things on the ground, and we are really capable. And militants, and especially that whole conflict narrative is on the backside. Okay, there are people, but since over the last 5 to 6 years, when NIA has taken strong actions, at least for the first time, it is being felt that something is being done, other than the kinetic efforts. And so the NIA summoned people from Greater Kashmir, the newspapers, and some mainstream politicians also, in cases of terror funding. That had a massive impact on the mindset of the people. And especially after the 370 was abrogated, I mean, it's really difficult to believe. Some people who were former militants, and still they have sympathies, they told that, that good that all these corrupt politicians are inside the jails. All these corrupt, top-notch separatist leaders who made money at the cost of our sweat and our blood, who made our kids die in the battlefield, they are inside the jail. Please continue with that policy. In the future also, if the government goes very strongly after these Jamaat-Islami cadres, the hardcore radicals, these movies, and all the people who are the coordinators, the main financiers, I think it will be amazing success for us in the future. As far as controlling the narrative is concerned, the young minds are ready to come out into the open, especially the young Kashmiris. After the 370 abrogation, we need to support them and we need to incentivize nationally. Thank you very much, sir. And also,
I agree with you. All the best.
Thanks for mentoring me, sir. Thank you.
Permit me to leave. All the very best, and we'll keep meeting. Take care.
Yes. Thanks, sir. To all the panelists, I think Major Gaurav Arya had to leave because he had a meeting, but we have, I'm just keeping the house open for the question. So we have this first question. I'll read out the questions just. Where do these terrorists get their weapons worth lakhs and crores, and where do they get their refill? Another question, what's the entire geopolitical situation about arms manufacturing? Anyone who wants to take up this question? This is from our audience.
Yeah, I can take this up if you like.
Yeah, please do, please.
Yeah, after this, maybe I'll also leave. See, I think it's a very good question, because we don't, these guns are coming from across the border. Where do they come from? And, you know, for what, where do they get ammunition from? For example, it's a gun you can still hide and keep, but ammunition is difficult to get. So there is a large, unfortunately, there is a kind of a smuggling network which operates through Pakistan. Pakistan itself has got so many guns inside it. Everybody, every second person has a gun. They themselves produce AK-47s which are unmarked. So that is also available. But there is, unfortunately, this is something we should highlight. There are also on occasions weapons which the US has given to the Taliban which has come into Pakistan and then come into Kashmir. So the if you can somehow tackle the weapons aspect, it will be a huge, huge advantage for us. I just wanted to take that question. Oh, okay, I'll just leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Tara. Yes, we have another question. Does India have a strong intelligence footprint in POK? Does India have a strong intelligence footprint in POK? Anyone who wants to take up this question?
What is your view?
Professor Nalapat, would you like to take up this question?
I have no idea what kind of a footprint we have. I do have a very strong footprint there, but I frankly, as much idea as you have, it is almost nothing. But the reality is that, you know, I would just like to say about Kashmir. Now, we have been talking about NIA and all these activities. We have been talking about Huriyat being, delegitimized. I mean, initially, this government started off with Mehbooba Mufti. I mean, first Mufti Mohammad Sayed, VP Singh fame, and then Mehbooba Mufti coming as Chief Minister of Jammu and Kashmir. And I mean, that created a huge problem. So the reality, where is the analysis of the past? Where is the accountants' accountability of the past? And frankly, a lot of this needs to be in the public forum. In the United States, you have public hearings in which these matters are discussed publicly. And in India, none of this happens. Anything that is considered to be government work is still considered to be beyond the comprehension of the voter. The voter is expected to give votes and to select the government, but is not expected to know exactly how the government works. So, very important one to make an end here. Psychological warfare is very important. In the case of Narasimha Rao's government, he operated from a very weak hand and somehow managed to hold the whole thing together. He didn't have a big economy. He didn't have international support. And frankly, he had no domestic support at all. Inside his own party, you had people like Tiwari, Arjun Singh and others who were constantly sniping at him. Sheila Dixit and not to mention Sonia Gandhi, constantly sniping at him. But he did it because in large part, there was a lot of effort on psychological operations. For example, reminding Kashmiris about what Afghans, Punjabis and Pathans had done to them in the past, making Kashmiris feel welcome all over India, and various other, ensuring that if a Kashmiri had, let us say, a terrorist had killed two people, he would not kill a third. If he surrenders his weapons, okay, things will do. And subsequently, that Kashmiri was somehow, got the motivation to take up arms against his former colleagues, which is when the insurgency started melting away. So despite bad conditions, now here, psychologically, we have all been saying Kashmir is an inalienable part of India. For me, frankly, it's important to get back POK, very, very important. And I think that should be a priority even in Modi 2.0. I'd like to see that happen. And it can happen if a proper geostrategic policy is done. The reality is that Kashmiris, especially this 15%, must believe that India can never be defeated by this Pakistan thing. Never at all. And today, in the past, they used to talk about America. Bill Clinton will save us. I remember in Kashmir, in some homes, they would keep photographs of Bill Clinton, their so-called savior. Today, America, they know, is coming close to India thanks to Prime Minister Modi's diplomacy. China, now they are saying, no, China will help us. China will ensure that Kashmir remains free. And China has certainly gone to POK in a very large way. The government has so much of information on this, which you and I don't have. Why it is sitting on that, like a miser sitting on his gold, is something that beats me. The reality is, we have all the capacity in place for a masterful campaign of psychological operations, including operations designed to ensure that the Pakistan militarized state melts down into independent republics that have got human rights and democracy flourishing between them. Why these are not being used? Why they have not been used? Why for so many years, the Muftis were brought into power and only later on, people woke up. It reminds me of our civil servants. They are outstanding people. 85% of them are honest. All of them, of these 85% are motivated, patriotic. Only a few are not. But the problem is that they only get enlightenment the day they become superannuated. So long as they are in service, they give you the same set of arguments. And the day they get superannuated, when you sit them for a tea, they get religion. They get completely different. It's like political parties. Political parties, when the day they come into government, they become different. The day they come into opposition, like now Rahul Gandhi, a strong supporter of free speech, a strong supporter of ending 377. Where was he during the 10 years of UPA? Was he kept in some closet somewhere where he could not talk about free speech? So this is the tragedy about India, that the people of authority get religion only when they have lost authority. And the people who have authority, unfortunately, many of them, the day they come into authority, they also acquire the trappings, the personnel, the mindset of those whom they, have replaced. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Narapasa. Just one question. So after this Pulwama, we did Balakot strikes, and we have set a certain standard benchmark that if you do any major casualty, major terror attack with the casualty going in double digit figure, we are going to retaliate either with a major surgical strike or with Pulwama or with Balakot style air raids, okay, or something higher than that. Now, Pakistan, coming back to that whole idea of taking back POK. Recently, there were some reports, and some of our friends told me that Pakistan has installed some very advanced air defense systems in the POK. And they were suspecting that, especially after the abrogation of Article 370, people are alienated, people are going through huge resentment. So even if there is a war, they might just revolt. Okay? And there was a strong segment, especially among the Jaish-e-Mohammed, the cadres and all, who actually wanted war. But the whole idea is that, how long can we actually do it? And how do we do it?
Yeah, Abhinav, I want to make the point. I don't believe that the Kashmiris will revolt. They are still, a lot of them are moderate people. And, and frankly, I don't believe you have the Shia, you have the Bakarwals, you have the Gujars, you have a lot of moderates. The small percentage that always appear on television, that always are cosseted by governments, cosseted by diplomats, they don't represent the Kashmiris. And the Kashmiris today have seen the ugly face of Wahhabism up close. Even the Saudis are moving away from Wahhabism. Even Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman of the, of the Al Saud family, which embraced Wahhabism in the very beginning, as you know, has moved away and, from Wahhabism. So, frankly, I don't believe that that kind of thing is going to happen. All I would like to say, it is very doable to take away POK from Pakistan. It is extremely doable. But for that, you have to have a clear concept of psychological operations. For that, for example, friends like Gautam, who are into nuance, who are into complexities. For that, you need this kind of strategy. and you need a broad base, such as, for example, even the Chinese are doing. The Chinese are very good at enlisting civil society, their academic communities, and their, you know, etc. In the greater cause. Now, what the question is, what is the India's greater cause? We have a greater cause, but some of us, like Gautam and me, who have been talking about it, have been vilified. I've been talking about it from 1990s, and I remember the feedback that I got, mainly that this is not going to happen. So I simply want to say, the idea of India, what is the real idea of India? That is what needs to emerge, and the Kashmiri must understand, the 15% especially, and the 85% also, that Kashmir is an inalienable part of India, and more importantly, it's a matter of time before Pakistan breaks up, and it's only a matter of years before POK becomes ours. That kind of a strategy is what we need. We don't need these half-hearted, half-baked strategies, which go, like, as I told in the beginning, antibiotics. You give a few pills, okay, the fever goes up, and then the disease comes back. It should not happen again in Kashmir. What we are seeing now in Kashmir, it should not happen again, that one more Sadbhavana, cloudburst is there, one more healing is there, and again these people are incentivized and revived. It has happened in the past, and may I say one thing, whether it is Vajpayee or Manmohan Singh, they have the same policies. This government keeps believing that, BJP, once you are BJP, you can do no wrong, and once you are Congress, you can do no right. I'm sorry, both BJP and Congress have their fair and unfair share of mistakes.
Can I add on something?
Please, sir. Please.
You see, one of the cardinal things that has to take shape is a database. Right from the NSCS down the ladder, no think tank has a database. And they don't want to manufacture the database. Nobody is going to give you the data to form your database. And all data which is classified is always from the open sources. There are very few data which is classified. My suggestion to any new think tank is, the first priority should be to manufacture a database so that you can connect the dots and the dashes, occurrences and incidences. Occurrences are a matter of fact. Incidence is a matter of statistics. How do you correlate the two? If you have corroborating sources of data, then you can easily connect the two and find out the intent. None of the think tanks invest enough or even try to create a database on the basic of what their aims and objectives of that think tank is. The IPCS had at one time one of the finest databases on peace research. Okay, but if you look at the broad spectrum of the think tanks in India, they do not have a database. So your first identity is, do you have a database on the issues on which you are going to work? And that takes a long time. And that is, unless you start right now, it has taken me 35 years to manufacture the database on strategic affairs. I have 20 terabytes of data, not 1 terabyte, 20 terabytes of data. Anything that you ask me, I can find out in my area. Okay, that is my intellectual property. Every institution which does think tankism must have two sets of exposition. One is for people to see that what we are thinking, which is open. The other is called the working paper. The working paper is only for the people who are working in the institute. Available only to them. Okay? Based on fine database. I'll give the last example. You've all heard about this institute called International Institute of Strategic Studies in London. If you are a member, you have access to the database in hard print. Okay? But if you are a part of II database, you have an access to the data. If you want to find today in IISS how many nuclear submarines are in the Indian Ocean, I as a member I will take about 4 to 6 hours to find that out from my database. But if I have access to the digital data, it will take me 10 seconds. That is the power. Information is power. And think tanks thrive on information, processed, and not stray information. My advice to any new think tank is start creating a database. Thank you.
Brilliant advice from Gautam. I just want to add a small point, Abhinav. In the United States, for example, you have these websites that are very nasty to India in the matter of nuclear, in the matter of Kashmir. Now, these people are being fed information. In the case of the nuclear thing, they have been fed information from within the US system for years. Now, our system has a lot of data on the rogue status of Pakistan in nuclear, North Korea, other countries that are built, long back designated as proxy nuclear states of Pakistan and North Korea. They have a lot of data on the oppression of people in Pakistan. They have a lot of data on the oppression of people in POK. For heaven's sake, what are you doing with that data? You're just using it to send all kinds of information to your fellow bureaucrats who will hide it away because they're in other countries. They don't want to offend Pakistan or China or any other country. So they will hide it away. Why don't you trust your own people? Universities and NGOs start with your own people, your own citizens with that data. If our system did not have data, I would not be frankly telling you this. There are mountains of data on nuclear proliferation by Pakistan, which they are keeping to themselves. Mountains of data on terror operations of Pakistan, which they are keeping to themselves. Mountains of data on oppression in POK and in Pakistan, which they are keeping to themselves. How long is this going to continue? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sen and Madhav Nalpa. Sir, regarding data, I certainly agree because I wrote two books on Kashmir. One is the radicalization in India, and Kashmir was one of my case studies. For me, it was so difficult to get very basic statistics like the number of mosques in a particular city, number of Maulvis, number of Iranian Maulvis visiting Kargil. The State Department, the State Intelligence Agencies, they don't share anything. And then the behavior is like, it's very arrogant. It's very unwelcoming for any researcher. Recently, I just finished a book on terror financing. And unfortunately, we don't have anything concrete, something which can be quoted, something which can be cited as a reference on terror financing in Kashmir. We talk about it a lot, but we don't have anything, something like a proper research paper on LOC trade, how it was used for finance terror, how the MBBS racket was used to finance terror. And I really had major difficulties. I had to interview the OGWs, former militants. They would tell you a different story. Then a proper intelligence officer would tell you a different story. Someone from JKP will tell you a different story. So that is a very hazy and a gray area where we are really lacking. And that constitutes our weakness, especially for the think tanks working in India. So with this, I end. And I would like to thank all our panelists for coming for this webinar and sharing their amazing, insightful views. Major Gaurav Arya had to leave because he had a recording. Thanks to him also. Thanks to Gautam Sen, sir. Thanks to C.D. Sahay, sir, Madhav Nalpat, sir, and Dr. Tara Kartha. And we would be coming out with many more webinars in the future. And main takeaways. So, like, we had such a long discussion. So, I would just brief, sum it up with some takeaways. First of all, we need very strong psychological operations, information warfare. I would say a strong force posture against Pakistan. If they are killing our army guys, we have to just, the war has to be made very costly for them, and a strong diplomatic initiative. All the participants who have joined, who have applied from far off places in India, from Andhra Pradesh, from Tamil Nadu, even a large number of people applied from foreign countries. My thanks to all of you. Keep visiting our Twitter page of Yuzanis Foundation, and our website will be up soon. Please keep visiting it. We are also looking for some good writers and experts, GIS analysts or experts in strategic affairs, intelligence analysts, areas experts. If you are interested, anyone, please feel free to reach out to us. We want to create a good platform where we can come out with some substantial documentation and good research. Thank you very much, all of you, and hopefully see you very soon. Thank you.